What?
Why is the baby crying? Why is the baby crying? Ooh. Ready for the labyrinth, Charlie?
Yeah. Oh, I don't have my instrument. Hold on. Don't call me out on the instrument.
Like Shiva? Blue like Shiva?
What kind of magic spell to use? Slime and snail. Keep up the hill. Wonder boy like a human baby said.
Oh my God. Ah, the baby!
I saw my baby trying hard as they could try. What could I do? My baby's mind had gone and left my baby blue. Nobody knew.
Baby blue, is that like Shiva? Is that what you're saying?
Huh?
Baby blue like Shiva? Blue baby?
Oh, I know. I was saying like Shiva. That's interesting, right?
Yeah.
Welcome back, Charlie.
What's up, everybody? Good to see you again, Indy. It's been a while. It's been a long, good couple of weeks, right?
It has, right? And we've been, there's like things been spinning and vortexes and full moons, and there's a lunar eclipse today. What's up with that?
Right. And Scorpio season this year has been really intense. So I went through some stuff too. So it's been really interesting to experience.
Well, first, like I have a lot to share with you, some updates, some science, some data, some cool stuff going on, some like stuff, physical things to share. But I think we should like just tune in and like what, you know, like just tune in what's going on. Like, right?
Yeah. Specifically the lunar eclipse.
Actually, let's start with that. What's up with this lunar? Like, can you give us some like what's up? Like, what's up with this particular one? What do you know?
You know, I actually have not looked into it. It's been kind of that, let's see, what is it in today?
It's in Taurus.
Oh, okay. It's Taurus and Scorpio are kind of like this opposite energy, right? I mean, you're a Taurus, right? So you totally understand, right? Yeah. But it's kind of like the moon really connecting to the earth, right? It's the moon is becoming, your emotions are becoming more grounded, more central, more like paying attention to the five senses, right? It's really grounding your emotions out. Right. You know, it's really important. And it's really, what's interesting is this conjuncting Uranus and Taurus. I mean, I don't know if it's exactly, but it's close to where Uranus and Taurus is.
Right.
Uranus and Taurus has been this revolution with Mother Nature and Earth, right?
Right.
So
right.
We see this whole, the soil revolution being that. And I think the moon coming in is kind of like also really bring that out into light again too, right? It's the soil again, it's understanding, you know, the Taurus energy is more that divine feminine, like Venus energy that comes out in the earth itself, right? And the different things that, you know, we appreciate of Mother Earth, and you see those great landscape shots, you know, those are kind of like very Taurian energy. And so the moon is really taking us, our emotions are taking us to that space. Yeah, which, you know, it's great during a time of Scorpio season where a lot of us, you know, we've had to actually a lot of fallen leaves, right? What do with the dead leaves? We actually put it into the ground, and the ground and compost it, and it allows you to mend the soil, right?
Right.
So the dead becomes part of the soil, the underground, right? And so this is where this full moon being opposite of the Scorpio season, which is the sun is in Scorpio, and that's why they're right. called moons, because they're opposite of each other.
Right.
In astrology. So we really get to see this, like, during the daytime, we're going to the ego death, but during the moon, we're going to, like, Mother Nature, remembering those lessons, right? The important lessons with our moon. And you're going through the... I don't have specifically Taurus broken down, but yeah, we can talk about the four elements.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just like, it's interesting, like, you know, like I'm kind of just also referring this for folks, because if they want to like actually get some like a basics of astrology, Charlie had, we had a play shop for the basics of astrology. And so Charlie had an episode where he kind of like broke it down, connected it also to like, you know, famous people we know, like George Washington, and you can see over here, but like also like, you know, they're looking at people's like, human design to also understand how they show up, but also with like using the signs, right? Like the elements, right? Connecting it to the elements as well.
Yeah, and it's really about understanding how the elements still play a very strong integral part in our lives, right? When we talk about the matrix or the cosmic labyrinth or the game we're playing, you know, what are the building blocks that allows us to work with this world? And so this is where the idea of education or the idea of knowledge passing down to the younger generation, so they understood the ways to work with their environment so that they can become the creator of that world, right?
Right.
And that's kind of like this, what we talk about is divine creator energy.
Right. Yeah.
So what's great is astrology really shows us, I kind of like to call it a report card of your soul and spirit, right?
Yeah,
and so
reincarnate
in this body, you have chosen kind of like from the experience what you want to experience next.
Right, right. Yeah, I mean, it's also like a good way to kind of like segue to like, you know, what's, you know, obviously with all this going on, full moon, my gosh, is Guru Purab. We today is also when we celebrate Guru Nanak, who was like an incredible humanitarian who taught about the unity of everyone. He taught about like, hey, let's look at the best things we all have to, like, doesn't matter what culture, religion, whatever you're, let's look at the best things that we have to offer and let's share that with each other. Like, what's the best things you got? I'll bring the best things I got. And we kind of like, almost like a video game, but like a spiritual video game, right? Like we're like, it's like spiritual role-playing, right? We're like, hey, look, I've developed these skills and tools from my spiritual practices. What did you develop? And we share it with each other. Guru Nanak was a master of that. So for right now, it's kind of crazy with all the immense, you know, I guess there's a lot, like, doesn't matter what you believe in at this moment, there feels to be a credible imbalance. And what we're doing for children, I mean, I can tell you, Charlie, everywhere I go, doesn't matter what parents they are, what backgrounds, they're all really nervous about what's happening to their children and what's going to happen to the children in the years to come. Like, what are the consequences of this past year? So I almost feel like spiritual, like, development, spiritual skills right now would be amazing to like develop for people, right? Like the spiritual science.
Yeah, for sure. And it's really important to actually practicalize it, right? And I think it's where a lot of people, and so it goes back to the moon and Taurus, right? Is, you know, how do we make our emotions practical so that we're actually using them, right? So often did we grow up with, oh, hide your emotion or put your emotion away. They don't work. They aren't useful. But maybe those emotion actually teaches us how to deal with things, right? So that we evolve our craft, you know? And so, you know, a lot of these, you know, so actually speaking of story, right? I went through that my own evolution of like what we've been talking about, the cosmic labyrinth, right?
Right.
But then actually living it and what that means, right? And so, because we had talked about how we were going to focus a little bit on the myths and the avatars of old, right? The legends.
Right.
And really rewriting those stories to work for our everyday needs, right? Because there's so many great, you know, and I think it goes back to like movies and literature and where we get these avatar archetypes, right? So,
I mean, but there's also the element of like I've been thinking about this a lot for what we're doing and how we, when we develop the cryptocurrency blockchain aspect, NFT aspect of it, right? We can do some great stuff with like empowering kids to create their own and maybe like acknowledging each other, their own mythology, right? But like, here's the thing. Some kids love to draw. Right. Some kids like to make music. Some kids like to tell the story. Some kids like to read and like just absorb it. So like, how do we like encourage those activities with each other? And really like, how do we empower kids to do it? To like, you know, how do we empower the artists to help support the storytellers, to help support the music makers, and they collaborate and connect, but they also earn value. by connecting and creating together. Like they actually learn that, hey, when we collaborate and come together, that also like we can earn something from that. That's how value is created, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, what I've been really focusing on is actually focusing on stories that have really built the camaraderie mythology in the story, right? So like Power Rangers, something I grew up with quite a bit. Ron, right? It's this fractal of color warriors coming together and doing things together, right? And I think right now we're seeing it in anime, right? So what I really love, and this is kind of like because of my Virgo Leo duality, I really enjoy the drama and the shows. But then as a Virgo, like I'm very introverted and like to focus on like internalize information and tries to understand pattern.
Right.
So what I enjoy doing is doing cosplay, right? I love dressing up and becoming characters. And to me, it's kind of like a way to connect to our different parallel lives that we experience even in TV shows, right?
Right, right.
But a lot of times these characters, what I love about Power Ranger is the warrior that fights could be taking a whole nother character that is wearing the suit, right? And so you can take those, you know, beautiful archetypes of the Power Rangers where they have different personality. It could be the five elements, it could be the four elements, right? And represent those guardians. Even in Captain Planet, right? It's the four elements plus the fifth being heart. But we can then take that to every culture and allow them to have like the face of that storyline. But then when they kind of like power up, they power up into this greater force that is a protector, right?
Right.
And what's been interesting is-
you remember this monkey? Do you remember this monkey?
I do remember the monkey. He's the monkey of the earth guy, right? So you could tell that he was connected to other animals and spirits.
That's...
So I think the earth ring could have been, they could have taken that character way further, right?
Because they made him weak. He was always weak. He was always like always in trouble. I was like, what?
Yeah, exactly. It's like, oh, I need help. Everybody, you have no powers besides being able to talk to everything and every being. I'm like, why can't you make that a better thing?
Why can't he just, also, why can't he help bring redemption and forgiveness to the evil people? Like, he can use his power to, like, make the evil people, like, look at themselves and be like, oh, my God, why am I doing this, you know?
Well, I think the heart ring was kind of like the placebo ring, right? And it powers the placebo effect, which is you connected to everything, right?
Right.
And so if he's, like, always, you know, and it's kind of like the idea of what we get trapped in the love of attraction is we may not be realizing subconsciously we're attracting things that aren't necessarily good for us, right?
It's true.
And so this ring is kind of like when you think about it, you could have a heart ring and go, hey, everything I believe in, I put into this crystal ring. And we see that even in crystal development, right? When we talk about working with crystals.
Right.
So Naruto and in chakra system, right? So what I've been working with since my costume in Halloween is actually did a musketeer. I was a musketeer. I really love the idea. I've had, I think, you know, probably
the three musketeers.
Yes, during the musketeer, right? However, you know, musketeer was actually not a, it was like the military force of the French royals, right? And so they represent kind of like this idealistic group of people that were protecting the land for the considered at the time the state, right, which is a government ruled by a monarchy.
Right.
And then what you had is actually the Battle of the Red Musketeers that dressed for the church.
Ah.
So you can have during that time blue versus red. Red were the cardinals. Shoot. Yeah, and they were protecting the religious faith. So they were doing things out of a religion dogma, loyalty. And the blue musketeers were representing the monarchs, right? The monarchy that was representing what was law and order on the land. And a lot of these cultures talk about the sun god. And so a lot of these monarchs were considered like the son of the sun gods, right?
Interesting.
Yeah. So what I really enjoy doing is actually chose, I wasn't in there with any other three people. So I was not a three musketeer. And a lot of people thought I was D'Artagnan, which is the fourth one that comes along and learns from these three. It kind of made me think further about this whole idea of archetype characters, right? Like, what if I broke away from the traditional musketeer story? I'm a musketeer, right?
Right.
I'm going through my personal life of what it was to be during the medieval days, which today you could easily create some analogy to how we're living in the dark ages of spirit, right? And we have a lot of people who are just living not from the heart, and you have these warriors, it may not be guns, it may not be swords, but maybe guns, and maybe, you know, we don't carry swords around, but maybe sticks, you know, something right. that like, protects us. But this idea of cosplaying, because cosplay, costume play, wearing costume is a very like yeah. in every religion, right? There's yeah. a version of that where they wear a mask and they change into a different character depending on the theme of the carnival or whatever's going on.
Right.
Totally. So, you know, what if we use that? And so I want to plan on play use that on making the costume more like I'm going to a parallel life. And I'm self-reflecting my own issues of today in the times of the revolution, of the French Revolution. You know, I'm, because I have French background, you know, I studied French stories, you know, before I was, you know, up till 10. Then I came to America, learned American stories, and I'm Vietnamese by culture. So, you know, I have a lot of Vietnamese stories. And even then they've been, you know, tweaked a lot by different colonies. And so, you know, as a child of the 80s, born in multiple countries, experiencing multiple cultures, you know, what is it that I can gather from all these archetypes, but then maybe rewrite it so that it's a little bit more relevant to my story,
right?
To my life, right? And so this is kind of like where we can go back and say, okay, cosplayers, like, yes, I know you love these characters from these anime. What if you're now your own character in this right. anime, right? It's like, right. pick a Jedi, whatever Jedi, and be a Jedi. Don't be yeah. the Jedis we know about.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that's just then becoming an archetype that may not be us, right?
True.
And what I love about a lot of the anime cosplays, you see that the characters are so well written that people will choose, not always the main character. And that's why when you get like these huge cosplay teams, like everybody becomes one of the characters in the show, which right. allows this diversity of characters.
Well, let me throw this at you too. I was working, mentoring with a 10-year-old. A 10-year-old goes by them, right? Neither he nor she, they're identifying as them. And one of the cool things like that was coming from our time in mentorship, because they were coming out of a divorce, right? So a really tough situation, was cosplay. And we started cosplaying and they really enjoyed that. They changed their hair, all this stuff. But we also started talking about how their cosplaying was a way for them to deal with the mental stuff that was going on with them, right? So like we were talking about yin and yang and actually wearing clothes and like making the hair and embodying the yin and yang in a conscious way to recognize the darkness and the light, right? And to recognize that even like the conversations that they would have about death, I'd be like, oh, great. Let's dive into it more. Let's talk about death a little bit more rather than being like, no, you need to go to the psychiatrist. And like, you know, you're talking about death. It's like, no, like maybe this is something that we need to talk about through cosplay or through mythology to understand it more rather than fear something that's natural. Right.
Yeah. And it's really interesting because we did just go through the time of Scorpio and we went through this whole Halloween and then there's a Day of the Dead, All Saints Day. There's a lot of ancestral spirits that really, and people talk about the veil thinning, right?
Right.
And I really believe that if we looked at it further and saw what it was meant to be, which was a ritual to connect to our ancestors and then get information, right?
Right.
Like,
right.
what if it was a time where, like, let's say I always talk as if I'm playing this video game of life, right?
Right.
So what if it was a time where they say, hey, we can access old accounts that no longer live, but they can give us secrets, right? Of a game that we're playing, right? So it's like, I'm going to come here to Gandalf, right? Like,
yeah.
Whatever, right? Whatever character we believe, but like we're connecting, like the idea of channeling these characters right. and getting information and being able to hear their version right. of the story, right?
Right. I guess there's different levels of that too. Like, you know, some people are like beginners, right? So maybe they just want to like start wearing certain clothes and stuff. And I think that's where Cosmic Labyrinth comes in, right? Like, I think because we already have such an incredible set of educators that like already have worked with kids from Waldorf to everything else to other, you know, even I've been an educator in many different capacities. You have, the thing is, right? Like we can meet kids and inner kids wherever they're at, right? If they're ready to build their cosplay a costume, we'll support that building, right? To create the mythology of them creating their own inner higher self, for them to create their higher self with it on the like within the real world, right? But also I think it's like connecting the digital space too, right? So like acknowledging that these kind of archetypes and this mythology, when kids start to integrate this, It's also how they could deal with the internet and social media. It's also how they could deal with challenges in academics or challenges in their community, right? Like there's, they want to make a difference in their community. They can make a difference as a superhero or as, you know, one of these like anime, you know, this guy getting powers, but like instead his powers are about how he can focus because he can meditate an hour a day. So he's got more power of focus, right? And that translates to the real world, you know? So we can offer these ways to digitally, virtually, and physically improve oneself.
Yeah.
And they can make physical representations of that.
And so if we bring back the idea of the matrix, right? This whole idea where like you go into training mode, right? So you're still in the matrix, you're still working the matrix, right? But you got to learn how the matrix works. And this is kind of the idea that, you know, this labyrinth is, you don't know what teachers you need because we don't know what teachers we're going to, what students we're going to get. But that's the power of allowing anyone and anybody to come and see how they connect and share their knowledge, right? Because there's just so much specialties out there. But I do feel we're also getting to a place where we're multidimensionally skilled, right? And so, you know, there's just so many things people are like always saying, oh, you need to focus. However, maybe sometimes we are not able to understand something. So we need to like learn lateral information so that we see the bigger picture, right? Because even when we talk about in martial arts, it's not just about punching and kicking.
Right.
There's actually a spirit behind why you're doing the martial arts and even why there's different techniques of attack to defense. Right. And that's the spirit of the art. But it's a regular punches and kicking into different ways.
Right. Here's a construct. OK.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So this is really what
this looks like. This looks like an Amazon warehouse. Is a matrix construct the Amazon warehouse?
I mean, today, yes, but what if it's like our imagination itself, right? And we're like, we want guns, okay? And the universe is like, here are all the guns. Okay, let's be specific, you know? And this is how we Google things.
Right.
You know, I want a car, okay? What kind of car? Four-door, two-door, you know, truck, semi. Okay, I want for this family, right? Yeah. So you need a filter.
Or I want my mom to be happy. Or I want my dad to be like, to feel like he worked hard and he's like, feels good and he feels content. And he doesn't need to drink and he stops drinking. And like, he starts to, you know, like it could even be those imaginations of starting to think about your family, the people you love, actually like finding healing and like seeing that healing happening, you know, before it happens.
So we could go over a different kind of because a lot of it is simulation, right? What if they say this, like, what does that mean versus speaking about that? Yeah.
So this is a whole, so we go down this rabbit hole, but before we go down this rabbit hole, I want to share some cool stuff with you. Like, I'm going to take myself off of this thing and check this out, Charlie. Look what I got here.
Ooh.
Some cosmic labyrinth.
Yes.
And peaceful flower essences.
Ooh, tell me more about these.
Flower essences. So one of our teachers that's on the cosmic labyrinth squad, she's one of our witches, cosmic educator, awesomeness. She created this for kids and inner kids. I keep saying inner kids because we all have inner kids. Can we just remember that, you know? So this is what we're doing with Cosmic Labyrinth is for everybody. I keep getting people ask me and I'm like, look, listen, Disney could make it for everybody. We can make it for everybody, right? But here's the thing. She made this, and she's gonna be making a series of these that goes in different cosmic kits, right? The kits that we're going to be sending to anybody who wants to buy it. It doesn't have to be a kid. It could be an inner kid that wants this, right? So each of these boxes, every few months, what we're going to do is we're going to offer different kind of like concoctions, offer different kind of toys and games. They're going to be offered in these boxes, physical boxes. They're going to go out and mailed out to people who are going to support what we're doing. So kind of like a Patreon thing, but we're not going to use Patreon. We're going to just do it. We're going to make it open for anybody to access it. Not so somebody's middleman is like just taking it. Like, let's find a way to get rid of the middleman.
We'll have our own little store, right? Bizarre.
And so this, I Am Peaceful, I'll tell you what's in it. So anybody can use this. If you want to feel peaceful and you're feeling a little bit anxious or stressed out, this is what's in it. It's got structured water, vegetable glycerin, arnica, chicory, echinacea, golden yarrow, heather, impatience, pink yarrow, rock water, white chestnut, and yarrow. Suggested use 2 to 5 times per day, maximum every 2 hours, 4 drops underneath the tongue, mixed in water, topically or in a bath. Do not take with food or flavored drink. So there's even directions of what not to do, right? So this is like an example, right, of something. This is from Bracci, by the way. Of course, Bracci's going to make something. What an alchemist she is, huh?
Yes, thank you, Bracci.
Bracci making this. So then I have another thing. I don't know where it is. I got to find it. There's a box over here. Here's a box. So check this out. Over here, I go in this box. And in this box, I find... I find these bags, right? And I have a huge box that was delivered to my home. And I have a ton of these things in them. And it looks like these are some sort of toy, okay? And when you bring these together, like here, you have different ones. You have this, and then you have this one, right? And they connect. So you have like a, looks like a fire.
Yeah, that looks like a fire element. That's so cool.
And the fire element can go in to this other element, right? And it sticks in here and it starts to make configure. Now check this out. What
atoms?
What do you think this one is?
Oh, maybe air?
Air. So we could put this in here. Okay. And they connect. And what do you think this one is? Notice how they're different shapes.
I think that's Earth. That's definitely Earth. Earth is square and solid.
Cube, right? So then you can put this on here, right? And what else do we have over here? We even have a little heart piece. Look at this, Charlie. Cosmic heart.
Ooh, cosmic egg. Yes.
So we could make this our little head over here. Now we kind of are starting to create something over here. Look at this. What's going on here? You give it even like little, you give it little feet. Right? Okay, we're giving it little feet over here.
Like an elemental being.
Elemental being. We could put maybe a rock. And now look at this.
Wow.
So we basically have created, and this is Mick's amazing art. Mick is also one of our awesome scientists, artists, teachers that has created a game, a toy. And this toy, by the way, Charlie, I put this in front of a few adults. I was at this place called Mother Tree in LA in Topanga. And I put this on the table and you should have saw all these like adults turning into little kids, like making stuff and like creating cars and all kinds of stuff. It's like Legos, but it's Legos with elements. So we're also learning about how to do elements. You could also draw these, you could color these, right?
Nice, yeah.
Yourself, right?
However you want to.
So these are going to be in the cosmic boxes, as cosmic kits as well, my cosmic boxes. And then I go even further and I find this, Charlie. Look what I find. Whoops.
Oh, beautiful. Marquee verified. Oh, are those seeds or, oh, it's a tea.
These are tea that was created by Sarissa, right? And so you have these teas that are to support with clear mind and longevity. So if you know somebody's feeling like they need to focus and they're stressed out, boom, you make this tea. And it's also really good just in general for improving the immune system, strengthening people, all kinds of good stuff. There's a whole list behind here of like what the benefits.
Wow.
What they do.
That's so cool. That's beautiful, Sarissa.
Cosmic Labyrinth.
Cosmic Labyrinth. Amazing.
So we got these amazing things that are going to be in this cosmic kit, okay? Mind you, I have something special to add in there too. And I think Charlie might have something too, right, Charlie?
Yeah. I wanted to show some stuff, yeah.
How about this guy? Hey, are you going to add something to the cosmic kit? He only speaks in a language I can't understand. It is elemental language. What? I don't understand.
You have to go back to basics.
We'll put this guy right here.
Light language. At that point, it's light language.
Light language. So go back to the matrix over here.
Actually, so I wanted to share where I was at with my own stuff for the kit.
Yeah.
So I officially finished and uploaded all of the files to the printers. So I'm almost done. I'll just do the desktop for now. So,
whoa.
Let's see. This is the box.
Nice. Dude, that box is awesome.
Right?
What?
So it's going to be 122 cards.
Wow.
Let me show you. I was going to show you actually where the... And this is the cards being loaded right here.
So, wow, look at those cards, dude. It's like they like remind me of Yu-Gi-Oh or like Pokemon card or like even sport, like those Marvel cards back in the days.
Exactly, right? I mean, I grew up with collecting comic cards to herb cards to all kinds of cards, right? And, you know, a lot of it had information, but I couldn't do anything with it, right? Mm-hmm. So I really wanted to build these out so that we can actually have like really fun games. So one of them is playing them like a solitaire game, right? So each category could be solitaire.
Nice.
And then there could be a game of goldfish, right? So what if, and this is where you can play with your kids, right? Play goldfish with your kids and they learn these subconsciously because we give them so many games and card games to play, but you know, it has to be fun. And so how do we turn this into a very fun-
And colorful, game? And colorful.
Yeah. Here's, let's see if we can click on it to see, nope. But yeah, this is kind of where I've been working. So this is going to be the earth, because back here is going to be for earth, right? So connecting nice. The earth element. I love this idea of, have you ever seen those books where the spine of the books, if you get all the whole set, it will make-
Yeah, like yeah.
So this is one of three images. And so if you put the three sets together, it makes a really cool image.
Cool, I love that.
Yeah, and this is really basically just what it is. It's traditional Eastern medicine herbs. And how you can use these. And those were the cards. And so that first set comes in here and then there's three sets to make the first single herbs class. So really kind of gamifying really difficult, like, you know, post-grad classes, but really thinking about them, what if we're able to teach these to high school kids right. and then them have, you know, basic understanding of medicine yeah. so that, you know, they can, you know, innovate on top of that in the future, right? So simplify yeah. mechanics. Because what's been really interesting is I'm learning that not all acupuncturists are required to learn the herbs with the acupuncture, with the integrative Western medicine. So we actually have to take pharmacology, learn all the pathology in the Western medical schools, right? And so that's been really tough because that's kind of like using three aspects, you know, three theories together and putting them together, right? But the herbs have been like what most people struggle with. And so this idea that I could make it, you know, visually fun and engaging rather than like old school way of like,
oh yeah,
you know, writing it down, you know, I feel like people were writing down on whiteboards all the time, you know,
like
10 hours straight. I'm like, that cannot be the best way we are memorizing this day and age. So I'll throw in some of these cards in there, you know, maybe, I mean, I don't want everybody to learn all of these, but, oh, Indy, you're frozen in time. Are you there, Indy? Well, I'll continue. The idea that we could have a couple of these really powerful herbs that are used often, that we see often in nature, and put them into the cosmic kit. And so maybe we can have kind of different kits that sell different things during different seasons. You know, we can have kits for like the fall season. So we put a lot of the herbs that are really important during the fall season. You know, we have some for like when it gets cold and some when it gets really hot, right? So we can have a lot of those herbs there and it could be collect them all kind of experience. I think it's still recording. So I'll wait for Indy to come back. So those were the herb cards. There we go. Woo, we're back, everybody. There was a bleep in time.
We're gonna have to use this module over here. Remember this, the other internet solution.
You're using the
phone.
5G.
Oh yeah.
Woo.
Yeah, man. I mean, I think like it's what I really like about what's happening right now is, you know, just to update you on other things is that I've been coming across a lot of data and information about how many kids are not going back to school, like all across America. Like there's so many parents are not having their kids go back. I've been to like several different gatherings from the Bay Area and LA and finding so many parents who are like, they're just so sick and tired of the education system and they want something different. And it's kind of crazy how like the need is there, right? But like the innovation is the innovation has caught up to that point because a lot of the innovation is performative, right? Like it's not actually dealing with the problem. They're like, oh, here's a problem, social media, blah, 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 kids are blah, 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 blah. But like they're still coming from the same system that created those problems. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah. It's really interesting because, you know, I have had this conversation with just in general everything, right? Because, you know, we talk a lot about like, hey, let's leave the system and then do it our own, but then like people aren't there, right? But we go back into the system, how much of the matrix, right? And this whole idea, it's like the matrix doesn't get to stay. We are in control of the matrix. That's, you know, people leaving the matrix is not being involved in the matrix. It's kind of like pulling out in the game when the game is like the best at this point, yep. Right? And it's, so I think it's really a lot of this like transformational energy of like, how do we get into that space and transform it and be able to use our own abilities to be clever enough to share the wisdom, the spiritual wisdom through the system, right? And this is kind of where like the idea of memes were really clever because if you think about it, you know, it's like what I believe is the organic versus synthetic conversation, right? Between organic life versus synthetic life, the AI versus the human experience, right? Or the spiritual experience. And nothing, if it's, we bring in this humor, we bring in this cleverness to things, but we're still trying to teach a message through it. And that's how we can beat the algorithm. And also in general, just like how we're really going to wake up people into really owning up to their skills and abilities, right? Because the idea that we talk about in the spiritual awakening is really own who you are and live by it. And the only person that knows that is yourself, right? Yeah. And that's a very difficult, scary kind of concept for everybody when we've been so used to like, someone is gonna save us, someone's gonna fix this, someone's gonna do that for us. We pay someone to do it so that you don't have to do it, right? In the end of the day, what are you doing? Well, you're working so that somebody else can do something you could be doing, you know?
Yep.
And that's why education really supports that. And we have to change and say, hey, you know, it's funny. I've been watching a lot of Instagram reels and try to see, you know, like figuring out how we're going to really build an audience there to really help share our message, right? Our message of like gaming, education, and spirituality, which is what I think a lot of parents and kids are looking for. So how do we make education fun again? But it has a spiritual connotation and we can all come together and work together.
Look at this crazy statistic, Charlie. In Dallas, Texas, right? Out of 150,000 students, right? Only 11,000, I'm adding them up. 9,000 high schoolers, 2,000 middle school, that's 11. So out of 153,000 students total in Dallas, 13,000 are unaccounted for. So one basically a tenth.
10. Okay.
Are like, where are they?
Yeah. Yeah. So there is a really great place where, you know, how do we work together to share knowledge together, right?
Or just create an, like meet them where they're at. Like they're on technology, right? They are interested in cryptocurrency, you know, they're interested in something, right? They're interested in some gaining value somewhere else rather than this world, right? And at the same time, they want to connect with each other. Like they want meaningful connection. That's they're finding meaning or through social media, but can there be an alternative? And can there be an alternative that the parents would be like, hey, here is an alternative. Like here, try this out. Like, you know?
Yeah, giving parents more tools, right? To work with their kids. Yeah, it's funny. I've been seeing a lot of advertisement for classes on Instagram. You know, this is a girl, she's been selling the whole Family Robinson story, but how those are practical skills to teach your kids, like how to cook, make a campfire, make food, gather herbs, harvest, you know, like if we were living in nature. And that's kind of where I think all the things that allows us to connect to nature, you know, if we go back to the four elements, let's start with earth, right? Like how many of us know how to access the matrix of growing food and vegetables and harvesting and using it for everyday life?
Exactly. Right. Charlie, did you see some of the emails we got recently?
Oh no.
Yeah, we got emails we got emails from parents. We got an email from her parents. She's got She's got kids, and she's interested in virtual nature, ancient cultures, and VR gaming. We got another email from somebody who has 3 kids, 10, 8, and 6 years old, and they're interested in all of the things that we're offering. We even have somebody, looks like somebody has a similar, somebody said, this is what they said in the email. This is a similar vision of mine. The digital piece being different, but everything else is pure gold from my heart to yours. I feel very connected to what you are doing and would love to talk with one of you by phone. Looks like I'm gonna give her a call. This is amazing.
Yeah, we should definitely plan it out and talk to them, talk to her.
So yeah, so it's like a good example of like, hey, we're just like putting something out there and it resonates with people. It fills a need, right?
Yeah. We should, so we could definitely plan for like a quarterly conversation and bring, you know, invite everybody who's leaving us messages and then say we're going to address some of these conversation and ask, you know, open up like, what if like we're the modern day community, right? And the community is a digital space because we are sharing things that, you know, we're not in competition because whatever you do may work, but we're not living together. And so we should be sharing this across the world.
Yep, exactly. Exactly. And be creative about it, you know?
What's really interesting too is a lot of people have left, you know, their degrees. They're, you know, I know a lot of engineers, and I'm an engineer who's left their degree too. Like, you know, as an engineer, I wanted to build and fix things, and I didn't learn any of that. So I went and built my own things, right? And here I am making like herb cards through support. Like, you know, I think engineering went too much into tech and computers and like cars or machines. Like, engineering is everywhere. Engineering is like fixing things and building things and making the world work. It does not have to be technology. It does not have to be electricity, earth, nature, growing plants
Engineering is farming. Engineering is social. Engineering is social connection, like dealing with conflict management engineering.
Yeah. Like social engineering is, I mean, that was one of the things that we did when we learned like actually how to hack. They said that digital hacking is mostly social engineering. You have to engineer the social setting to get their credentials. Instead, it's faster to get their credentials for them because more of us are more trusting. And so getting their information so that you can hack into their software is better and faster than doing it from their computers.
Right.
And so, you know, social engineering is really anthropology, psychology, sociology, you know, all of the psychosomatics and psychotherapy stuff.
It actually brings it all together. Like it kind of really, because like social engineering at the end of the day is when it comes to politics, it like ends up going up towards politics because then it's like decision-making on where resources go, education, like what things should we watch out for? You know, like,
and what's important in psychology is understanding where we have blind spots as humans, right? When we get emotionally triggered, we have blind spots and suddenly we're not paying attention to what could be working for everybody, right? We're looking for what could be working for the couple who just got really angry or crying right now, which we find in society where like sometimes the whiners get a lot more attention than the ones who have been productive and changing their life, right?
that happened a lot. I noticed in school, like growing up, like I would notice that like because like in our culture, right? I mean, I'm gonna celebrate Guru Nanak, right? Like we get taught to be humble, to work hard, to give. Like it's automatic to like not like cry, not whine, like to be resilient, to like, you know, like yeah, you should step up if there's injustice or imbalance, but it's not about like making it all about you. It's about supporting other people, right? That's how we were brought up. And like, it was weird because like, I noticed over and over again that like in my classmates and people growing up, the people who got the most attention from the teachers, the people who got like the most recognition were the ones who kind of like, they were kind of like wanted the attention. They seeked out the attention, you know?
Yeah. Well, what I've noticed in being bicultural, right? Because I think a lot of us immigrants who came from, you know, original place and then came to America, what we found is there was this cultural dynamics that were kind of throwing us off. And I think what it is between the individual and collective, right? Mm-hmm. You know, as an Asian, like we were a very strong collective community, right? And then here you come here, it's all about the individual. And I think what we need to do is find that balance where you're an individual, but you are part of a community. So you get to be a better individual that works with the community rather than separate community. And you're out just being, you know, someone who does not pay attention to the people around them.
Exactly. Exactly.
And I think a lot of times too, we do get caught up in that we have now like a hive mentality where everybody who tells you what to do, you suddenly start to kind of go, maybe that's right. And it's like, maybe that's not right. And you getting upset maybe is a reason why we have to recognize that sometimes our emotion tells us this is not good for me right now. And I don't have to succumb to peer pressure.
Exactly. Yeah, super important.
And I think that we see that even in like education. Oh, if you don't study this, you're not going to make money. Well, I don't know that, you know? Like, seriously, I don't know that. You don't know that. Like, it's really funny because now you see so many artists in the Etsy store doing so well, right? Mm-hmm. And that's been removed from all the schools now, right? Like, you can't draw, you can't paint, you can't do music, we can't do art. Yet Etsy store is flourishing. Everyone is making money by selling products that they are. I've seen people make things out of clay and like jewelry. I'm like, I didn't know you make jewelry from clay. Like,
right.
But I knew that in art school, but like we just did something useless. Nobody wore their art in art class. But if you told me in art class, you could actually make something and then people buy it and kids can make things like other kids might enjoy and pay them something.
Right.
You know, that will be a closer way of trying to explain how to be, you know, your own entrepreneur or your own, you know, business, right? Rather than having to like be forced to be somebody you're not and spend like 30 years like working for a business that doesn't really care about your talents.
Exactly. Yeah. And I feel like that's where that's where like one of the things, like, you know, you could feel the pulse of the situation, and there is an opening where technology gives us this amazing way to scale at a beautiful way. Right. It can be very toxic too, but one of the ways that it can be supportive is creating an infrastructure that allows kids to encourages them to be creative, however they want to be creative, like encourages their curiosity, however they want to be curious. Right. And like in that space of curiosity and creation, right, that's where virtues can be presented. That's where we can talk about shadows and shadow work. Right. But in a way that kind of is more about storytelling and personal storytelling, collective storytelling, but really it's like creating an infrastructure that's like using cryptocurrency and blockchain, but that's just a part of the story. It's like acknowledging that people need a different type of value system, right? Like they need it,
Right. And kids, what cryptocurrency is actually, it's just a currency that has a lot of value based on the psychology of people, right?
And so
that's what we set the intention for, what we want the cryptocurrency, because today the dollar sign doesn't have an intentional value, right? But this idea that we have diversity of currency means that there's heart behind, or there's a spirit and an intention. Whether there's heart or not, that's a different conversation. But, you know, if there's a strong intention behind the currency, we as a collective will probably work together to make that intention work. And that's why the currency is very powerful. You know, I think when we talk about currencies, it's really about how does it allow us to be our creative divine selves, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And like, how do we like create some sort of wave? I mean, I'm reading a book right now about karma, right? And like, how do we create, you know, like the crazy thing about karma is like the moment you start to count it, like the moment you count your actions, the moment you count your deeds, you now are creating, you're creating negative karma.
Right. Yeah, right.
It's funny how like currency, literally most currencies we have is just counting stuff and we're not even counting it anymore. Somebody else is like valuing stuff. So like, think about all the negative karma we're procuring all the time, expecting money for things that like, don't even need money actually.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. I mean, just the aspect of value means, you know, you're creating the disparage, right? Or the like that there's a them and that, you know, there's an existence of this and not that.
Exactly. And so I think for us, you know, as we build this, you know, whatever we call it, karma coins, heart coins, whatever we develop, as we develop this and continue to build partnerships and relationships with people who are like-minded, right? That really come from a place of integrity, because we're making stuff for kids. And I think that makes it there's a different vibration there, right? Like we can't just make something and then like pump and dump, like which most cryptocurrencies are, right? Unfortunately, you know?
And it's more than just kids. I think it's for all of us. I think even, you know, the problem is we don't work with kids. We don't connect with kids. We don't work with them as if they're our equals. We always create this inferior complex or
this we gotta have poor kids, we gotta help them, you know?
Exactly. Like, no. Yeah, no, maybe they know more than we do, but you know, this is where, again, the shared knowledge, right? Like, what is your experience as an adult who's lived on Earth for a long time that you can share with the kids, and it's not your negative projections, right? Like, what can you really offer these kids?
And mind you, Charlie, if we're listening pretty well, if we can listen to the kids pretty well, they may give us really good innovations and create, like, we know, like, Charlie, you know, we know how to build stuff, right? And we know people who know how to build stuff. So, like, what if the kids give us ideas of how to solve climate problems? What if they give us the solutions of how to do solar power better? What if they give us those solutions, right?
And that's why it goes back to this idea that we're like, kids will answer things so honestly and truthfully and so simple, yet, like, we are so baffled by the wisdom. We're like, wow, like, how does that kid know that? And it's like, that's because we overcomplicate everything, right? I mean, everything
does go back. And then the next day, we're like, stop laughing, sit down, be quiet. Like, oh, you're so wise. Okay, shut up. Yeah. Go talk.
Yeah, something does not follow the program. You're not smart enough.
You were really wise for that moment, but outside of that, just shut up. Don't laugh. Don't play. Okay, get to work. Memorize. Okay. Charlie, sit down. Memorize. Okay, I want you to memorize for the next 3 hours.
Yes. And then if you move too much, we're gonna say you have something called ADD, so that you just cannot pay attention.
And I got a drug dealer that I know. He's a MD drug dealer. He'll hook you up with whatever you need so you sit down and be quiet.
Yes. You can follow the program, okay?
You need to focus, okay? You need to focus. I'm going to give you the best drugs, okay, for ADD, for ADHD, OPP. You know me. I give it to you.
You know that ability to see with your third eye? We don't need that. We don't need that. No. We can fix that problem. It's called too many eye syndrome. You have too many eye syndrome. So let me fix that for you.
Your ego is too big. You have too many eyes, okay? Cut down your eyes, okay, please, sir.
Yeah, if you were supposed to see the eye, it'd be coming out. It doesn't come out. It doesn't work, okay? It's broken. Just, we'll take it out for you.
You need too many eyes. You need 2 ears, 2 eyes, okay? Not 3. Okay? But yeah, man, I think that's, you know, that's so much of the key is for us to kind of like understand that we're creating something the world has never seen before. And it's also kind of cool, like, it's celebrating Guru Nanak today, right? Celebrating somebody who's like, who is so dope at bringing people together from all walks of life, right? Like, we desperately but not desperately, because we're not desperate, we're actually going with the flow, which is beautiful. But like, the world, the consciousness, the human consciousness is seeking something not just universal, but something collaboratively universal. Right? Like, that's kind of the thing, right? Like, what does that mean? Like, everybody's so egotistical. Everybody wants everything to be theirs. Like, I made that. I made this. I did this. How can we create something that's universal knowledge, but also is like collaborative? Like, hey, what do you got to offer? What are you bringing to the table? What do you want to share? Right?
Yeah, yeah. So remember, going back to your question of how we get the different writers and artists and players and then the actors, right? And this is kind of what you experience in Hollywood, right? When we were in LA, and I experienced that a lot, you know, working at Disney and in movies and production. Coders too, you get different coders, you get different artists who are digital artists who make, you know, beautiful artwork for games. And I think, you know, I had my own projects and I brought in a lot of different artists and had to work with their own different skills, because not a lot of times you go, I want these 5 characters, and you get these other 5 characters, you're like, they don't fit my criteria, but that's all you got, right? So it's really also working with them to really empower the project. And I think this is where we go back to, like, what if there's a story that brings them all together,
right?
That allows them to shine all their skills together, right?
I know. The 12 crystals.
Yes. So I actually wanted to actually internalize
the 12,
this.
The 12 crystal skulls.
Yes.
Planet.
So I'm internalizing that game, right? Our game, but I'm becoming these characters myself. So the no-name musketeer is going through this, like, he goes through the blue and red conversation, right? Mm-hmm. And then what happens is he starts to realize there's a plot between both of them, and there's something else. Mm-hmm. And so he leaves the Musketeers and becomes more like this Dark Knight character that goes through like a spiritual awakening, that he realizes it's not red and blue, it's something deeper.
You know? Ah.
And so he goes in, and so there's like, so it's really cosplaying, but with purpose and with story, because a lot of people cosplay right now. Huh?
Purposeful cosplaying.
Yes, but exactly.
But that's also where we bring in the augmented part of what we're doing, right? Because
right, so this is where you can have the beginning of the story, but then you find other people, because now I find someone who's like a photographer, she loves to take pictures, right? And so she will love to take more pictures, but we need more models to kind of act out, but then we need people who maybe, because a lot of cosplayers are make costumes, right? And they become the characters, but they're also models, and so they'll model their outfits, but they can't necessarily make their own stories because there's a lot of copyrights, right? Because you're just plagiarizing, using kind of like what people are using. But if you created your own character in that world, it kind of plays
off. Yeah, but what if we make it so that it's like more focused towards astrology? And so, you know, people are cosplaying their higher self astrology, right?
Yeah. I mean, so this is where I want people to actually understand the astrology is the story of each of your reincarnation lives. But when you actually the higher self, there's no astrology. You're all astrology.
Oh.
Yeah. So when you play the reincarnated version of yourself, I'm a Virgo with a Leo rising in this lifetime, but I've been all the other signs.
But that could be like what you're talking about could be like, there could be like a superficial like understanding, but like, you know, like really good video games have a secret level, right? Yeah. Like, you know, like, yeah, you're quote unquote higher self is your embodiment, your cosplay embodiment of your astrology, right? But
it's more like your spirit, right, will play different games of reincarnation as the game, right? Yeah. And when he comes in, you have to roll the dice and choose what experience you're going to have reading that book. So what if you, like, I'm going to read Lord of the Rings, but I want to roll the dice and I'm an elf. And so I read the book based on an elven perspective of the book, right? And so that's kind of like how our consciousness is also involved in reading the book versus a lot of times when we read stories, they're very much, you know, you follow certain archetypes. And so you are the characters in the game.
So you just gave me a download of how to write my book, the children's book that I'm writing.
So now I'm also doing the same thing with our game, right? Because our game is I needed stories, but I'm now some of the characters in the story.
Yeah, exactly. It's way more fun.
Yeah, exactly. So now in the game, I already now came up with like the story that I'm going through is he's in the city going to the seven lieutenants, right? The seven dark lieutenants. And for him, when he like leaves this life, because then he goes through this black and white, light and dark battle between, he realizes what's running the city and he wants to deal with them. And it's a lot of like, I want to kill them, I'll kill them. But he has to go through this ego death that it's not killing, because then you realize you're the same, you're all of them and you're fighting yourself. And so he has to go back to the four elements and goes to the nature and connects with the cosmic eggs again, right?
That's too much info.
but in a lot of heroes' journey, you kind of see that, right? Like leaving the city and going to nature and connecting. Yeah. So we're going back into like the same story, but I'm a character living out that world that we built. Nice. And through that story, we can write it into the game and into like the experience.
Yeah. So
I'm living the story I'm writing.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? And when I go through the
But don't tell everybody, because then your story won't happen the way it needs to happen, because you're telling everybody how that's happening and then it's going to stop it from happening.
Oh, no. This is a lot of story point. Yeah, this is a lot of story point. This is just like one version of the growth, right? And then there's going to be astrology in it too.
Well, it's like the thing, right? When you watch a tea kettle, like teapot, whatever, you know, like you got to like look away too for the story to unfold, you know?
Yeah. Well, we'll have a trailer, right? So it's like I'm doing a teaser and people are like, wow, I want to know more. And that's all you're going to know.
Just get the tip. Yeah,
it's been interesting to think about how to actually use kind of what's happening today as our stories, right? Because a lot of great stories were written in timepieces where what was going on in society was a huge environment for the storytelling, right? Like To Kill a Mockingbird.
Well, it also becomes documentary-ish, you know?
Right.
Like documenting the battle almost, right. You know?
Yeah.
The journey.
Exactly. I mean, right now, like there's so much good topics, like, you know, COVID. It would be a great, like a plague is a conversation of some in our story where we can put that in the story that, you know, because during the time of the revolution, a French Revolution, there was a plague there too.
Right. It's true. You know, it's happened again, 1918. Like there's a plague in India, like during right. the Guru time.
So now you and I can make up our own, like we can go back in our own. So to me, it's like, I'm actually envisioning myself during those eras, experiencing the same thing that's happening now, which is astrological, right? Mm-hmm. So going back to Dark Ages, but also like during your times when you guys had revolution in India, and what did that look like? So right. you know, we can do some cosplay of that, which is telling a story again, but we are controlling
True.
The spiritual message, right?
Well, intention about doing like immersive experiences at farms is having like the character show, like, you know, I can channel my ancestors or, you know, my ancestral like archetypes, like when kids come to the farm, I can like talk about farming from that perspective of my culture, right? And like also embodying like some of the highest virtues of that culture and the silliness and the music and the creativity and the culture, right? The food. There's so many like elements kind of like immersed in that. And then the kids could walk a little bit further at the farm and there's like somebody who's from an indigenous community that's also embodying their ancestors in that moment, cosplaying, you know? Maybe cosplaying even a god or a goddess from their culture, you know? So.
Yes, exactly, right? And that's how we kind of embody the lessons as well.
Right, right. Dude, and speaking of which, I have to run to the temple now, the Sikh temple. There's like a little mini festival, food, music, celebrating Guru Nanak. So it's happening tonight.
That's amazing. Well, definitely enjoy her celebration of life here.
Heck yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's cool to think about like, I mean, I implore anybody who ends up watching this all the way, you should definitely check out Guru Nanak. Just research Nanak, N-A-N-A-K. Like this dude, just not too long ago, the 1400s, 1500s, he walked on foot with a buddy of his and they played music and they sang. And wherever they went, wherever there's corruption, wherever there was like imbalance of resources, wherever the communities were suffering, they would change the vibration of places. They would actually literally show tyrants how to be loved human beings, right? Like, cause the tyrants were actually suffering and they were able to use music, and Guru Nanak was able to use music, community, food, celebration to bring people together and to resolve conflict in a way that like, there isn't much documented history of the stuff he was doing recently. Like this is not mythological. Like this is like historical fact of what he was doing in foreign places. Like he went to like Saudi Arabia, he went to Ethiopia, he went to the Vatican, and he told the Vatican, how do you have slaves? Like he like sang to them. Like, why? Wait, you guys believe that all men
are- skit, Indy, come on. Let's do a great skit on this. But you like, you'd be great at like, you know, doing kind of a fair representation of like what was going on so that we could appreciate it, right? Because, you know, meet kids where they're at, right? I mean, they're not definitely reading these books. So, you know, there's a way that we can really-
Because Guru Nanak wore a turban. So there's so much bias in that, right? They just don't even listen because of the turban, but like how much we could learn from learning about these people who actually helped feed millions of people and helped change the dynamics of cultures and communities like crazy, you know? Without violence, like Charlie, without ever picking up a sword, without ever any blood being shed.
Yeah, the beauty of if we can really reenact this so people can actually see, you know, go, hey, maybe this was real, because a lot of times it's really triggering the remembering, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's the idea of like where the cosmic labyrinth is how do we help trigger each other to remember, you know, who we are, these multidimensional.
Well, that's where we bring in NFTs, right? So kids can actually, or whoever, kids, inner kids, can earn the NFT of Guru Nanak by learning about Guru Nanak, by engaging in some educational exercise. Right. And so that I can facilitate it. I can get somebody who's even more knowledgeable about Guru Nanak to kind of facilitate. It's a myriad of things. Maybe there's many elements, just like with Pokemon cards or Yu-Gi-Oh cards. Maybe there's like, you can upgrade to like level 3 with Guru Nanak by like going deeper, into his
T-shirt. Right, yeah. Same thing with the gamification of the cards, right? You get different degrees of the information and how the information evolves, right?
Those are NFTs. So you can have and maybe you could go to a Sikh temple and share that NFT and then you get value. Maybe at the Sikh temple, they do a prayer in your name or whatever, you know? So you can go to the physical space with that NFT and get value for it.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? Anyways, man, I love you so much. This is brilliant. We could just keep ideating. It's so awesome. And that's kind of the cool, just so people know, this is how we roll. Like when we get together, we do things that would take people 10 years to do.
Making our dreams come true, practicalizing our magic, right?
And with the speed of a vortex.
Yes. I agree.
Have a good one, brother.
Have a good one. Bye, everybody.
Bye, everybody.